evening, my dear brothers and sisters. I have great pleasure in inviting you all for a very, very interesting and practical webinar. The topic today is post-lockdown, the precautions for prevention and protection. You may wonder, this topic had been discussed in various forums. Why you are repeating here? Certain good things should be repeated again and again. For example, you say million times, no smoking, no smoking, but still people smoke. Same way, these webinars, any number of webinars you conduct, sometimes people may not be aware what to do. Small, small issues, small, small things. In fact, we have got very good, eminent stalwarts today participating in this today's webinar. Our beloved brother, Dr. C.N. Raja, who is the president of Tamil Nadu IMA, a dynamic president doing a lot of good work during this COVID times. He's also a renowned ENT surgeon. And then we have a renowned obstetrician, Mridubhashini, who is doing practice for the last 4 or 5 decades. And we have got Matthew Philip. He's the president of the gastrointestinal endoscopists of India. Each one of them will share their wisdom in the day-to-day practice. Now the present speaker is Dr. Suman. Dr. Suman is an orthopedic surgeon. He's a consultant orthopedic surgeon and a joint replacement person in the VGM hospital, Coimbatore. He had been working for last few days. In fact, I have collected a lot of webinar information from various webinars and few slides and gave it to him. VGM institution has got a very good team for especially in this COVID times. Every day they do some webinars. So they have got a very good technical team, videographing, auditing, audio recording and webinars specialist. So I requested Suman to compile all the small issues, dramatize or cinematize the whole thing and take video of each thing. So yesterday also we had a long discussion. Every day we had a discussion. I used to tell him, you had this, you had that. We were scratching our head how to do the blood pressure cuff sanitation, disinfection. So every time when you take a blood pressure for a patient, again you take the same cuff, it's not disposable cuff, BP cuff, you have to do the again. So what do you do in that? So like that, small issues we thought, and for everything, we have found some solution. And our Suman is like a cinema director. He made all the videographs of each and everything. And Arogya Seth is one of the good app which is developed by the government of India. Many patients, they don't know. So I told, I'm requesting everyone, when somebody comes to you, please tell them to download video, Arogya Seth in the hospital itself. And so many other things, we have discussed. I think Suman is going to first talk about all these things. And after that, Dr. Raja will talk what IMA has done so far and what the government is doing for doctors. All those aspects, Dr. Raja will highlight. And Dr. Mridubhashini, one of the commonest problems, and not problems, every day what we see, pregnancy, people coming for checkup, and suddenly they come for delivery, and the government says you have to do RT-PCR. So those questions he will answer. And our Matthew Philip, who is an endoscopist, there also there are a lot of problems. So he will discuss about that. And Raja, being an ENT surgeon, because ENT surgeons have more chances of developing problems. So how to protect them as an ENT surgeon and also generally as an IMA president, his words of wisdom will be there. Now, with all your requests, I'm going to ask Suman. Before that, as usual, I salute all the COVID warriors. I bow my head to all the people, doctors and paramedical workers who are doing day and night work. And during the COVID times, the doctors taking and the healthcare workers taking big brunt. And many people called me just now. They said they are not able to join because of some commitment. I told them at the end of the talk, with the experts' opinion like Raja, Mirdubhashini, and then a video done by Suman, the recording will be given to you so that you can play the video and recording in your hospital daily so that when patients come, they know what to do and what not to do. So with this small introduction, now may I have the pleasure of inviting Suman, the orthopedic surgeon, to give us the day-to-day issues and how we have to solve. Dr. Suman, please.
Thank you, sir, for the wonderful introduction. This is Dr. Suman here. So if you see, regarding Corona and COVID, IMA has given guidelines. My society, the Orthopedic Society, has given guidelines. And in the last 1 week, I called a couple of friends and got the guidelines from all of them. There were some controversies and some common points. And there are some more things like having practically how to approach this. So almost every day I've been bugging Murugannathan for almost half an hour. He was kind enough to have a chat with me and give me a lot of guidelines. So this is a genesis of ideas. And I hope at the end of this session, we can discuss more for the betterment of our COVID warriors. Okay. Can we have the slides, please? So, post-lockdown, how we have to prevent ourselves, take preparations, and even during lockdown now, how we have to prepare, etc. Now, the last 40 days, we have seen a lot of webinars. People are really bugged off it. But that's why this is a very practical webinar, which will be useful for even safeguarding our lives. So, a cause of anger and sometimes a cause of death. But let us be alert for the next 1 hour and see what we can do. Now, as an orthopedic surgeon, me and all my colleagues, we are very much worried about the word infection. In fact, if you see in the theater, we wear this theater hoods, etc., and safeguard our patients during joint replacement times. But now the tables have turned because we don't want to give anything to the patient and neither we don't want to get anything from them. So it is a bi-safety measure. In fact, there is an old saying which says, you can spit into an abdomen but not breathe into a joint. And as far as I know, the highest amount of safety precautions are taken by transplant surgeons, cardiac surgeons, and orthopedic surgeons. And we have put across the society guidelines so that we can decide how to go about it. This is a wonderful picture I found from the internet. When two real heroes meet, what do? Because they are more aware of the risk. So it is our duty to safeguard our patients and ourselves. All right. Now, let us rewind the history 2 months back. This was a paper cutting in February 24, as you can say. Even doctors were wondering why Corona has not come. Some said this is a latitude-longitude theory because of certain, the temperature zones India has spread across. But today we know the true scenario is not true. The virus has no boundaries. And two, as medical healthcare professionals, having read a lot and we keep being updated ourselves, for the safety of our patients, ourselves, our staffs, and all the medical legal consequences involved, we need to think about this. And three, this is just for a joke. And as you all know, TASMAC has opened in the last 2 days. And in spite of us trying to explain to the patients, even before the Corona times, we tell them, don't do this, do this exercise, don't smoke like Sir said. Still, they don't understand and they have a lot of fun regarding this. And this is a new epicenter for Tamil Nadu, the Coimbatore market. In spite of telling social distancing, they fail to listen to us. So it is our duty to take care of, at least in the hospital atmosphere, so that all of us are spared. And we have to avoid situations like the first Bilwara episode in Rajasthan, where the doctor, a 100-bedded hospital owner, became the epicenter for spreading the virus in his town called Bilwara. And he's now looked upon as an enemy and not as God. And Corona has a lot of strains and sometimes they don't present only as respiratory cases. They have dermatological manifestations. In Singapore, it is recorded as false positive. Dengue is coming and later Corona's testing is positive. And some patients come with abdomen pain, diarrhea, myocarditis, etc. So we need to understand this disease well more and more. And there was a time when, look at this newspaper cutting in the Hindu, it said it makes no sense for us to panic over the coronavirus, but now it is something to consider about. And yes, we should not forget the medical legal consequences. In fact, the IMA had to step forward in Agra and bail this doctor out because an FIR had been filed. Anyway, this will come in the video and you can read it across. And hospitals are getting closed then and there. So if we screen the patients well, we can take care of our center also. Many such instances are happening. And finally, as usual, when health is at compromise, patients become very emotional at the same situation like this. There are episodes when angry patients have spit upon doctors and healthcare workers, and we need not contract the corona and safeguard ourselves in such situations. So hence, I give you the VGM model of safe COVID-free practice, a generation of lot of thoughts on how to go about it. Five top rules. Number one, minimize the personal belongings. Both the doctor and the staff members and the patient who comes inside should bring very minimum items. Rule number two, distance from the patient. 1 meter must with a physical barrier in between. I'll discuss about it now. Rule number three, lesser surfaces of contact. The lesser the surfaces we touch and we make the patients touch, the better for both of us to avoid fomite transmission. Rule number four and five is about constant training and reminder for both and by staff and doctors. So if we have the stop fire rules, we can create a lot of solutions to safeguard ourselves and the patient. So this presentation will be useful for both single OPD suites, multiple OPD suites, having labs or x-rays, daycare units, small nursing homes, and even corporate hospitals. So the commonest item which is a source of fomite transmission is a cell phone, and this is a very small measure of just putting it in a plastic cover. There are cell phone covers which are available, but they cost 100 rupees or something. This is just 3 rupees. You can just put it like this. One of my medical officers taught me this, in fact, in a hospital. He took a demo, made it a tight seal, he dipped it in soap solution water and just wiped it and took it home for that day. So this is a very simple solution you can all follow. And this is like the Bahubali movie. Our hospital should be a sanctum sanctorum and like a fortress. And just like in the movie at the end, the actor, he convinces some way and flies around. The corona is also coming around in the air like that, and we need to protect ourselves. So we need to take a lot of precautions for that. So our hospital should become a genuine fortress. Now, this is our corridor where the cars usually ply and come. Now we have made an alternate entry for the cars, and we have put up a pandal, and the patients are first spaced, made to sit there. As you can see, we have kept at least 2 feet distance between the seats and the security guard, and there are two nurses. The one on the left hand side is our infection control nurse, and on the right is a nurse who screens the patients. So even early morning in the day, the chairs are placed widely apart and everybody is given directions what to do. And have a compulsory one patient, one attendant policy. And if the patient is sound of mind and can take care of themselves, request the attendant to wait outside only and not come inside the hospital. 75% of our patients understand and oblige this because they are also scared about the corona. And have a couple of standees. I've just put one example for you here, whether the patient has traveled outside, whether they have cough, fever, etc., to report. Because sometimes when in the height of the problems, let's say it's a patient with a tennis elbow for me, they'll be thinking, what should I talk to the doctor? And they forgot about all this history, about fever, etc., which they had perhaps 1 week before. And just like in Kalyanamadapams, etc., we have placed a 5-tap system with soap solution. The infection control nurse stands somewhere here and instructs each person to go wash the hands with soap for at least 20 seconds, number one. And number two, like Dr. Murunathan sir said, before taking BP, it is better if the patient can roll up their sleeve and before tying the cuff, they can wash like this with the soap solution and come, so that it's quite easy for us. Now, sometimes if the ladies are wearing a tight blouse or something like that, it's going to be difficult. So we have kept a few, 10, cloths, towels rather, small towels which are very thin. So that in case a patient cannot pull up their sleeve, roll up their sleeves, we put the towel and put the cuff on top of it, and there is no much error. And then that is put for, that the towel is put for washing. And the old age Indian custom of leaving slippers outside is definitely followed. And the floor is mopped at least 3 or 4 times a day, so the patients are not worried about leaving their slippers. And the same chairs with the patient, which is put for the patients under the pandal, is recirculated 3 times a day. Different batches are placed in the sun. As you all know, sun is a natural disinfectant. And of course, we use the chemical solutions, but this simple method is also followed. And look at the image first on the left side. That is a red line. This is just a demo from our housekeeping manager and our staff. And the infection control nurse from the center is looking upon at what is happening. The space is maintained between the red line. The sister stretches her arm straight across, which is a direct indication of at least 1 foot is maintained and another 1 foot is away for the patient. She checks the temperature. Please notice both are wearing masks. I'll tell you the reason why this mask thing is important. I will come in the next slide. Okay. And once she checks her temperature, she will ask a history about fever and travel, etc. And look at the two tables on the image on the left, on the right. The first day, 40 days back, we had this kind of a table. Within 2 days, we realized the folly, how BP has to be taken. And we made a makeshift arrangement with pipes. Our housekeeping manager made the system. So the patient puts the arm across inside and BP can be taken. And the pulse oximeter can also be slipped across in the finger. And same for employees, whether it's a doctor or a nurse, the temperature is first checked for them. And when they come, all of our hospitals are digitalized now. And when they want to check their, when they want to keep the thumbprint, that becomes a formal source of transmission. So we have kept a microshield, a disinfectant has been kept. I don't know his brand name. So a disinfectant has been kept right across on top of the fingerprint so that once they check, they use the sanitizer and clean themselves up. All nurses and doctors have been given 100 ml or 50 ml sanitizer of small bottles which they carry in their pocket and they can clean themselves regularly. Nowadays, we have the modern system of face recognition ID mechanisms where they just need not touch everything and fomite transmission can be reduced. And this is the front desk of the system. Kindly see how neatly it has been organized. One BP system, automatic BP system, one temperature infrared thermometer, one pulse oximeter, and one face shield. This face shield is a physical barrier for her. And actually there is an image on the side where there is a 500 ml sanitizer. Between each patient, a gauze piece is taken and all these are cleaned, and especially the thermometer and her face mask she cleans as often as she needs. Okay. So the rule of thumb is consider every patient a potential case of transmitter unless proved otherwise because it's a very infectious disease. Now, this is a part where I had a lot of issues regarding the community guidelines from Orthopedic Society, Gastro Society, IMA, etc. regarding what kind of head cover to use. Some said a head shield like this, like in the left. Let's start from the left corner and go to the right corner. The left corner, rather, this is a visor which the in helmets or cycles they use. It has almost a 270 degree coverage, number one. Two, the head hoods are available in different types, either with plastics in the front or without plastics, etc. So it is our jurisdiction and rationale how much we have to protect ourselves. Either we can pull a full head cover if you're a dentist or if you're going to work very close to the patient, etc. Because even day before yesterday in Arialur, one ENT doctor has tested positive. My dermatologist friend told me about it. So we have to know how much coverage we have to give for our different departments. Let's say I'm going to examine the knee of a patient. All I need is a visor, perhaps a cap and mask, which is more than sufficient. So as per our department, we have to discreet which type of cover we need to use for our head. And number two, what mask to use? Again, if it is a fever clinic, etc., compulsory, better to use N95 or N99 mask. But otherwise, for a general OPD, a 3-ply mask is sufficient. But the first rule is both the patient and the doctor and the nurse have to wear masks. There was a time cloth mask is said to be okay, but nowadays the demonstrations are you can even breathe through the cloth mask. There was even a video on YouTube where they keep a candle with lighted, and through a cloth mask you can just blow away the candle. So at least a 3-ply mask is compulsory preferred, and both of them have to wear it. Now, why both have to wear the mask? Look at this three images here. The top image, if it's a patient who's a 19 carrier, and even if we are wearing a 3-ply or N95 mask, our transmission rate is 75%. Please note my point. Even if it is N95, the transmission rate is 70% because N95 really sticks. And sometimes accidentally, we try to pull like this. And if you notice a small indent forms on the side and the virus and the air can go through across that. And number two, let us say vice versa. The doctor is not wearing, then the transmission rate is 5%. But if both are wearing masks and they're staying 1 meter away, then the risk is only 1.5%. And this is where the role of a physical barrier comes in. Now, since it is very cumbersome to have a face shield all the time, before I go to that, this slide I got from Murganathan sir. This was a fantastic slide to demonstrate how from the community or away from us, a mask helps two-sided. And when we cough, we do not give the droplets out and neither is pulled in. And an N95 mask will reduce the chances below 1% if you see if both are combined. That's why FFP2 or N95 is much better. But because of practical reasons, we may have to stick to a 3-ply with a physical barrier. This is given in some community guidelines. And N95 mask has its own shares of problems. Because if you wear it one day, wearing it the second day is going to be not really correct? Because the surface will have contamination. There was a time in some hospitals they kept it on the sun, but if you keep it under the sun, it reduces, I mean, it damages the electrostatic layer. Mask is of no use at all. So the best is to change the mask 4 days once. This protocol was given by AIIMS. They were the first in the country to bring it out, as far as I know. So on the fifth day, the mask can be reused. They can be kept in separate boxes with marking 1, 2, 3, 4. Mask 1 goes on the fifth day, mask 2 on the sixth day, and so on. But yes, the best way to safeguard an N95 mask, you can heat it at 70 degrees for 30 minutes, which I will show you how now. And so, like I said, preparation is half the battle, in the, whether it is from the patient side or the doctor side. We have four things we have to consider: a three-ply mask, the sanitizer or hand wash, and regarding Amprax for the patients, some scientific information I will come about. And as orthopedic surgeons, we always believe in the two-glove policy, because when we drill, sometimes the wires, etc., can tear. So look at this nurse posing for me as a model. Two gloves, a blue on the inner and white on the outer. Number one, if the outer glove gets torn, we know immediately, because gloves are very thin and they easily break through. And number two, these gloves, between patients, the outer glove alone is changed by the sister. Sometimes when the OP becomes high, she immediately takes some sanitizer and wipes the glove, which is more effective because the finger itself has lots of creases, etc. And this is a hot air chamber. This is not a commercial chamber. This is a house chamber. Frankly, we had this in a house. Every time we travel by bus, sleeper luxury coaches, or we travel by train and come back, we put all our clothes inside this and heat it at 70 degrees to kill all the bed bugs, moths, etc. So we transfer this to the hospital in the front. And our patients go for first opinion, second opinion, fifth opinion, sixth opinion, etc. So all the files and anything they bring, we keep this in the hot air chamber and zip it up. We can keep up to 4 kg of items here, and all we need is a few minutes and they become as good as normal. I read some articles and then only we started using this system. And the same, at the end of the day, we keep the N95 mask in this chamber and it becomes fine. And I spoke about the mask and the physical barrier pattern. Now, always wearing a visor or a PPE is going to be tough. So this method we followed from some other hospitals, we got this idea. As you can see, the standard patient divider in the center is having a transparent sheet. We removed the green sheet and put a transparent sheet. This is actually the security desk where the doctor is now sitting. The doctor will ask the questions, etc., and take the consent. And if you see on the desk, we have only, there is no rule number one, no cluttering of desk, no keeping mobile phones, no keeping coffee, tea, etc. And only the basic, the ortho pamphlet, the gastro pamphlet, the consent form, the prescription form, etc. is kept. If the doctor can manage seeing the patient here, we finish the story here. Otherwise, then the patient goes to the next level. This is the consent. Both for our safety and the patient's safety, a consent is taken regarding, are you aware of corona? Do you know what it happens? And there is a possibility you can get the corona either here or anywhere. Please understand the risk. Every patient, this consent is taken and it is filed every day on an everyday basis. This is an emergency department. We have 4 beds in an emergency department. As you can see, there is for a physical barrier, we have a screen. And if you see the image on the left side, you see the blue mark, pen mark. That is where after taking, once the patient comes, the sister sees the patient and pulls the screen. And then the doctor comes to talk. Then for examination, the patient lies down. We slip our hands across through the hole and examine the abdomen. Or I pull across the whole sheet on the body and examine the leg or the hand, whichever I want. So this physical barrier between patients, we just spray solution and clean it with a chlorhexidine. And this is a standard protocol. Many of you would have seen in other presentations. Yes, during seating the patient, we need a barrier, either on a 1:1 ratio or 1 and 2 chairs are closed and the 4th chair is opened again. This is the best way to space the patient. Once upon a time, BC means before corona. I mean, it's not before Christ. So this was how our OPD was. And I don't think for the next few months, we can place the patients like this at all in a hospital or anywhere else for the matter. That's why distancing is a rule. This is the Wuhan method, which all of you saw on the, I'm sure you saw on WhatsApp. We follow this also. We keep all small toothpicks are placed like this in the lift. Each person can take, they can press which floor they want and it is dropped down. Alternatively, in another lift, we have kept a sanitizer where mainly the doctors use. And number 3, fomite transmission is a very common spread. So even if it's a small clinic of, let's say, 1,000 square feet, even if you can reduce 250 square feet, isolate that area, because patients, doctors, nurses have the habit of putting the leg here, putting their hand here, sitting, standing like this, etc. So when the next person goes and stands there, they can transmit the virus. They become a carrier automatically. So we isolate areas of the hospital or the clinic which are not required at all, and reduce the square feet. The reception, as you can see, another physical barrier where the patient has to compulsorily stand 2 feet away. And the next problem comes, currency. All of us know currency is the most common cost. Now, what our sister does in the morning is she keeps loose change ready for worth at least 5,000 to 7,000 rupees. And money is transferred only through the blue tray, as you can see. Infection control nurse is giving a smile on the right side. She's trying to show her credit card and told me, don't show my number, doctor. So just for fun, okay? Right. So as you can see, the cashier receives the money with a glove. If it is a credit card, she will receive it. She will swipe it, place it back in the card, and then clean the machine after the PIN number is entered. If it's money she's getting, she'll receive the cash, put it in one drawer. Any change, she'll take it from the other drawer and give. This money is not touched for 2 to 3 days. This is the waiting hall. Now, there are 4 consulting chambers which were opened. The others were kept closed intentionally. So for each consulting chamber, a three-tier chair system is placed with a marker in between. So once the announcement is made, table system 1 and chair system 1 match, and they have to go there automatically. Now, let's come to the OPD. Now, Dr. Muruganathan sir gave me a wonderful idea here also. Actually, once he said, we have started implementing here, because the fan has to be behind the doctor. It should not be, let's say the patient is in front of you, the fan should not be on the other side, because anything the patient has will come towards us as a wave of air. So it should be either in the center or should be behind us. Now, once again, look at the OPD, the table. All our doctors have this habit of collecting medical samples, pamphlets, newsletters, journals, invitation cards. Our table is fully cluttered. Nothing is allowed, no extra papers are allowed, and only there are only 4 forms here with a pen. And this pen will never leave the table. Irrespective of who the doctor or nurse comes, once they write, they have to keep it on the table and walk off. No pocketing it. And no switching on AC. And actually, you can see behind the chair, there is a door. Our OPD suite has 2 doors, on the front and the back. As you can see, this is the back door and this is the front door. So for purpose of cross ventilation, both doors are always kept open. And this is a transparent screen again. Once, till the patient comes and sits, the doctor does not open the mouth. Staff does not open the mouth, and once they come behind the barrier, history is started to be asked. One more example of OPD suite, the same 2 doors policy, a physical barrier and minimum table items. And when the patient is waiting in the waiting hall, there is a TV where something about corona, about immunity, some immunity boosting foods, etc. Authentic information is passed across to the patient in the waiting hall. And this is a blood collection again. You can see my sister, the infection control nurse, is standing to overlook how things are going. So the hand comes across inside and the blood is drawn by the lab tech, because sometimes our lab technicians bend so much nearby, the patient's face comes hardly a few centimeters away. So this barrier avoids them from doing so. I think we'll need all these measures for the next few months to come. And one more thing, people started ordering on Swiggy, etc. As much as around, I think, 6 instances throughout the country has been reported that Uber Eats and Swiggy boys have become positive. So we don't want to get infection the wrong way from these kind of people. So this is to be banned in our clinic or hospital. And telemedicine. Even 4 days back, a pediatrician got in trouble for trying to get fees. When a patient subscribes for telemedicine, it is an implied consent. I've checked this with some telemedicine experts. I've also seen in many of the webinars which happened. If it is a patient who's asking for the telemedicine, then it is like a regular consultation. The only rule is we have to record the conversation at least digitally, or preferably, at least on paper or digitally. If you can record whatever you spoke, you are safe. So telemedicine is an accepted norm, especially in a crisis like this, there is no problem. But record keeping is a must, and there is no problem in collecting fees the right way. Hand wash, I need not tell much about it. Now, between hand wash and sanitizer, there is still a controversy going on. But if a hands is soiled, hand wash with soap for 20 seconds is a must. Sanitizer alone is not enough, because when the dirt is there in a hand, it is not sufficient at all. So just this is from the Aladdin comic when Aladdin tries to give a hand and Jasmine gives the sanitizer. So sometimes hand wash is not always practical and we have to go for sanitizer. But the problem with sanitizer is also the cost and the problem of availability now, because there is so much shortage. In fact, in Japan, the government has declared vodka as an adequate sanitizer at homes and in hospitals, because they seem to have more alcohol than the actual sanitizer itself. And always try to maintain your stocks. There are three items which are very important now: your gloves, your mask, and what you call the visors, and the PPEs. Always check these stocks every 5 days so that we don't go down on that numbers. And touching the sanitizer bottle is a problem. So try to use a mechanical device like this. This starts from 600 rupees to 2000 rupees range for different models. As you can see, a leg patient presses the leg and the sanitizer solution comes out so easily. Whereas these automatic sanitizers, there was a time 500 ml dispensing sanitizer was only 1500 rupees. Now they have hiked up to 6000 or 7500 rupees. So let us go for simple cost effective solutions also. And regarding what sanitizer you use, if you take the same Dettol, it comes in three different concentrations. I'm sorry to use a brand name, but just for example, because it's a common solution, a 70% alcohol ethanol has been proven as the best sanitizer we can have. The same Dettol even comes in 11% concentration also. And there is no doubt for metallic surfaces and handles on the door, sanitizers are better than even sodium hypochlorite solution. Do PPEs help? PPEs help, but they're very cumbersome. And in an OPD sitting, it is very difficult to wear this and see all the patients. It is not a practical solution at all. Because once we wear the PPE, donning and doffing becomes an issue. And number two, there are some places where they said you can hang the PPE. But imagine, you're going around walking with the PPE and then you're hanging it. It touches your calendar, it touches your cloth, it touches the wall, etc. And this becomes a source of fomite transmission. And not all models of PPE are washable, so it becomes a problem. And there are circumstances when the patient, and there is lack of PPE, people just sleep off like that. I mean, doctors and staff nurses, so that they can get up and work again. And at BGM Hospital and other centers, when I made a lot of calls, everybody said a minimum of 60 GSM PPE is mandatory. 80 GSM and 90 GSM is better, but breathing through becomes a lot of difficult. I myself tried for a couple of cases and I prefer 60 GSM at least. And this PPE should be impermeable type. A lot of fake manufacturers are making the local handloom weavers with permeable type. It just comes across. So take a model, pour a solution and see. Let's say take a betadine solution and see. Let's see whether it passes through or not. And scrub dress. If you are in a fever clinic and if you're sure you're not going to touch your face, the one on the right side, the green image with the glove is fine. But otherwise, wearing a half sleeve gown is the best as per WHO. Because we wear the half sleeve, wear a glove, and if required between patients, if you think you have accidentally touched somebody, remove the glove and clean with soap above elbow, just like a surgical wash. This can be done even in our tap. So for now, half scrub dresses are much better and regular washing between is much better. This is right now on sale. There is one dealer in Bangalore also who's selling this, the powered air purifying respirators. I personally haven't tried this. I spoke to one friend in Bangalore. He said he tried for one case. He finds it okay. This PAPR costs 15,000 rupees and it has a battery with the oxygen backup, but it lasts only for 1 to 1.5 hours, it seems. And like I said, I don't have further idea about this. But this is much better than a PPE because you're very comfortable and oxygen is flowing through across for you. And just outside the hospital, the one all of us drive cars and go home. These are the 8 touch points given by BMW car manufacturer as a social welfare measure. They have put it across that everybody touches these 8 points. So keep a 500 ml sanitizer in your car and clean these 8 points often before and after getting out of the car. And coming to the main area of controversy, how to clean up our clinic or a hospital, what we should do. There was a time we all thought the virus was heat resistance, but now we are still not sure because they say, there was a time they said it was heat sensitive and now they say it is heat resistant. And the virus can stay up to 72 hours on metal, plastic, etc. So clean your OPD at least twice. And there are two top solutions of choice. One is Lysol, which is 80% benzalkonium chloride, and bleach, the common bleaching powder diluted with 2-1% sodium hypochlorite solution. So Lysol 80% available commercially. If you see the Lysol website, there are 20 types of Lysol. So choose the, whenever you buy a Lysol, choose the one which says 80% benzalkonium chloride. Take one capful of it, add to 4 liters of water, and any computer electronic items and lifts, Lysol alone is more than sufficient. But as such, bleaching powder hypochlorite solution of 1%, add 800 ml water to 5% commercial hypochlorite, you get this concentration. And you can clean anywhere from tabletops to floors to walls to ceilings, everything with this. And as such, and regarding fumigation, this is an area of controversy. Many people say UV light is required, but they're not sure about it. But at least for now, at the end of the day, try to do fumigation. It's a very cheap method. It costs only 600 to 700 rupees to fumigate a huge twin theta complex. Now, fumigation with any solution having hydrogen peroxide 11% and diluted silver nitrate 0.01%. Again, these fumigants are available in 3 concentrations, and this concentration is the best. I just used a sample. Envodil is one brand. This is a sample I showed it. And yes, we can teach our patients. It's not difficult at all. Keep standees. Avoid giving pamphlets. All of us print pamphlets and give to our patients. Don't give it in the hand. Patients have the habit. They will read the pamphlet, drop it, and the next person will take it. So it's a form of transmission. So pin the pamphlet in the file, and they can take it home with them. And like I said, in the TV, in the waiting hall, you have a recorded video or PowerPoint. So we always have to remind the patients in different ways to take care of themselves forever. So when police people can put yellow lines, we can also frame our rules and regulations and follow some rules. So that's why I said we understand the risk better and we need to be more cautious. This was the first slide I put. And we all know even today, there is only a 60% efficacy in demonstration of these RT-PCR method. And sometimes we miss the patient in the window period or incubation period. And considering the population of our country, even if you're planning to do a surgery for a patient, it is very difficult to cover everybody because we don't know whether the patient is truly positive or negative or not. And it is our duty to inform the authorities if a known quarantine patient, weekly once at least a known quarantine patient intentionally or unintentionally come to the hospital, when we probe the history and find, we immediately inform the authorities because we cannot help it. And if it's a known travel case or a suspected case, once again, it's our duty to notify. And as doctors or anybody above 40, we are also diabetics, etc. So we should take care of our immunity, take adequate rest and exercises, give appointments, only 6 appointments per hour, 10 minutes per patient, take adequate spacing, clean the OPD in between, have a buddy system for the sisters. One sister will point the mistakes of the other. In fact, 2 sisters in a hospital have this chocolate technique. One will start telling the mistakes of the other one hers. Whoever wins at the end of the day, they have to give a chocolate to the other. So if they are motivated to point out each other mistakes and correct themselves, they'll all be fine at the end of the day. And UV rays, companies are telling UV rays works. There are a couple of articles which also supports, but they are not fully confident. Level of evidence is very poor. And the commercial UV rays lights is very expensive. For example, this picture which I've taken, I don't want to name the company. This is for the theta complex and they charge 45 lakhs. This dealer from Coimbatore charges that. This is for one theta complex. We can't afford to spend so much at the same time when it is not a proven technique. And these 2 manuals, the Jay Ziang manual and the WHO manuals, give a lot of wonderful ideas. Both are freely available online and downloadable. It comes close to 100 pages and I've taken some extracts from them and put across some ideas for the hospital and for this presentation. So as doctors, we have a second chance of life. We have a lot of problems. We have a lot of abuses. Let us try to do the best. We can take care of both the virus and our patients. We can break the vicious cycle. And we need not take it as a burden. But if we all follow some principles, I'm sure we can be safe and sound. I always like this lady. Of course, many people said this statement. But hear this out. Nobody likes to hear this, but it is the truth. We are not living through the final phase of this crisis. We are still at the beginning. We will still have to live with this virus for a long time. In some countries, it's projected the virus may stay up to 2022 also. For India, let us try to break it even much earlier. And this prediction came again around 30 days back. I'm sorry. But we have broken this prediction. This projection from some Indian Institute of Technology or somewhere, they said by mid-May, we'll have 5.35 lakh rise cases. But we have not touched that so far. So far, we are going in the right direction. And let us try to make it much better. So take home message, Corona is here to stay for a few months. Let us accept it. Let us unlearn each and every step about our hand, our face, our actions, etc. Definitely, though our patients and staff will be bugged in the beginning by so many orders, they will definitely welcome it that we are taking care of them so well. And let us not have a heroic or casual attitude. So let us safeguard ourselves and our patients. So with this, I conclude my presentation. Sir, you're on mute, sir.
Unmuting, yeah. That's okay. Yeah, that was a very good presentation, Dr. Suman.
Yes, sir.
Before I go to Dr. C.N. Raja, there are a couple of things which I think which must be also noted.
Okay.
When a patient comes to the hospital or OP, the nurse or the receptionist should take a detailed history and take the mobile number. And also, whenever you do anything, you cover that with CCTV camera. Now, because sometimes the history they may hide. So, cover that with CCTV camera. And also, if possible, tell them how to download RHS government app, because that is very good for patients, very good for us also. So that's one thing. Then it is always better if somebody has got pulse oximeter along with the BP, you also check the pulse oximeter with all the safety precautions. Because many a time, patients may not have fever, but when you do pulse oximeter, the oxygen saturation may be less. So that also, I think you should keep in mind. So my suggestion is take a detailed history, do under CCTV camera, take a pulse oximeter and note down the pulse oxygen saturation. I have got more questions and more comments. I'll come to it later after my friend, brother Raja gives a talk. Raja, are you there? Raja?
Yes, sir. Yeah. I'm there. Raja,
now, as a president of IMA, you are doing a lot of good works. Every day you are in touch with the government and you are giving a lot of information. Now, first, as an IMA president, you give your words of wisdom. Then I'll come to you as a ENT doctor. Now, first, as IMA president, your views and your advice and your messages. Over to Raja.
Thank you and good evening to all for this very good and wonderful opportunity to be with you in this evening. I think Dr. Suman has very nicely and elaborately explained everything. I hope I am audible to everyone.
Yeah, you are audible.
Okay. Of course, we never seen such a challenge in the past last century. We never heard such a big issue which is threatening without any barriers in between the countries. Real changing time and has changed everything. Whether it is good or for bad, we'll have to wait and see. But as of now, it made everybody going for a standstill. And one thing we should know that the governments all over the world spending quite a lot on the defense and other sectors, which is waste. And in fact, they have not invested so much on the health care sector, that too on the public health. Even the highly developed countries like Italy, France, and UK, USA are all struggling a lot on this COVID issue. But on the other hand, India has done reasonably well. If you see the statistics and how things have been going on for more than 40-45 days. And in fact, we should really appreciate the central government and the state government, individual state governments, for their involvement and taking appropriate, immediate and necessary steps to prevent a widespread of this disease, which is spreading in a lightning speed. Initially, we all thought this is being imported from the other countries. Then later on, we were talking about it all came from Delhi, and we are talking now, it is all coming from Coimbatore. So whatever it may be, now it is, we have crossed the stage 2 and slowly creeping into the stage 3, that is the so-called the community spread. And we all know that about 80% of them are asymptomatic, and these asymptomatic patients can spread the virus very easily to others. Now our aim is to safeguard the elderly individuals and persons with the comorbid conditions. Even the government of Tamil Nadu has now insisted that home quarantine can be undertaken with the undertaking taken from the patients. So from the IMA point of view, we started this so-called the awareness about the COVID more than 4 months back. In fact, in January itself, we started doing so many awareness programs. And in during our state council meeting at Vellore, we had a separate session for dealing with this corona infection. Many of our seniors were talked on that forum at Vellore, including Dr. Muruganathan, one of the senior person. And we in fact made a several resolutions, like creating awareness among the public by handbills, videos which we made and spread across, and making awareness for our own doctors by means of sending all the protocols, updates as and when required, which is still we are doing even now through WhatsApp, email and bulletins. Also, we made a first resolution in the country, all over the country. I'm very happy to say we made a resolution that all the frontline workers, including the doctors and nurses, especially the doctors, if they get into this corona infection and die, they should be given an insurance coverage of 1 crore. And we sent it to the chief minister, all the top officials, including the union health minister and our prime minister. With the perseverance, with continued the updates and inputs from our national leaders, we got this 50 lakhs coverage. And initially it was for the public sector, and later on they included the private sector also with the input of the IMA. And I'm very happy to say in every aspect of the central government and the state government, they always invited the Indian Medical Association to formulate the protocols, inputs, ideas and guidelines. Whatever we give, they have taken it very seriously and implemented. That one aspect I must say, because you all know that IMA is the one of the largest NGO in the world. We have about 3 lakh doctors all over the country, and about in Tamil Nadu about 37,000 doctors, and in Tamil Nadu we have about 170 branches, and all over India it is nearly 2,000 branches we have. And of course we've been our Indian Medical Association of Tamil Nadu was invited by the government of Tamil Nadu to be a member in the expert committee. We were given 2 representations, and we were telling the government of Tamil Nadu how to go about that in the first lockdown period and the second lockdown period, and also in the third lockdown period. And on 12th we have another meeting. One meeting was at secretariat, then later on we had webinars. And in fact the
I think the connection is interrupted from
seen by more than 1,000 centers all over the country, and we had leading faculties, Dr. Soumya Swaminathan from WHO and Dr. Velu from Atlanta, and faculties from Australia and Germany, and our national faculties. And this was initiated by our, inaugurated by our Honorable Health Minister. Subsequently, we had statewide webinars, and again, our Health Minister participated for more than 1.5 hours on this webinar. In fact, we highlighted so many practical points during that. And again, this was attended by the National President himself. And we have we were leading, the Tamil Nadu IMA were leading in the rest of the country on so many aspects, like starting the community fever and respiratory clinics. And we have prepared a model and given to the National IMA. National IMA very much appreciated our model. And the state IMA, state government of Tamil Nadu, appreciated our model and given permission to go ahead, because we need a clear-cut government's permission, which we could get it within a span of 3 or 4 days. And we started this fever and respiratory clinics in our state of Tamil Nadu, which is free of cost, with all set protocols, with the disinfectants, with the PPEs, and I need not elaborate on that. And subsequently, what we thought, it is high time that we should also go in for sort of telemedicine consultation. I'm very happy again that IMA Tamil Nadu is the first state to start the telemedicine among the state branches. And with our IT wing, we have formed an IT wing. When I took over as the president of Tamil Nadu, I started the IT wing, and we have made so many changes in our working pattern. And this IT wing started the telemedicine platform, and more than 1,500 patients already got benefited by utilizing this platform, which is free of cost, and which we have very boldly explained to our national IMA, and they were really surprised how we are doing all these things. And subsequently, we appeal to the government of Tamil Nadu that they should also come with some solution for the frontline COVID warriors. Initially, Chief Minister of Tamil Nadu announced 10 lakh rupees. And I'm very, very happy to say that he invited me as the President of Tamil Nadu for the video conferencing before the first lockdown, and what to do and how to go about this. Our entire people, the senior people, I had a, before going to him, I had a discussion with our people and got the information, and everybody said the Tamil Nadu should be treated as a single unit, and it, the lockdown should be extended. And we have given so many other inputs, which was in fact implemented. And I'm very thankful to the government of Tamil Nadu, especially to the Honorable Chief Minister. And subsequently, again, when there was a big issue, calamity, crisis of denying a decent funeral for our own doctors, which you are all very much aware, I immediately rose up to the occasion and appealed to the government of Tamil Nadu that this is cannot be tolerated. The entire doctors community of the Tamil Nadu, especially in our own state, and the entire country is deeply hurt and emotionally charged. So immediately they called me for a meeting with the Chief Secretary, the Health Minister, Health Secretary, DGP, DPH, DMS, and the Health Minister. And we requested that whenever there is a death when fighting the corona patients, doctor dies unfortunately, or the nurse dies, they should be given a state honored funeral. And number two, and they should be given state awards at the state function. Number three, the solatium should be increased. Number four, those who were opposing the decent funeral, they should be put under the Gundas Act. Number five, and there should be a protocol for all the hospitals whenever they see inadvertently a COVID patient later on, they seal the hospital and they never open the hospital for a long time, and there should be a set protocol for this. All these, our requests were immediately within 24 hours accepted by Honorable Chief Minister, and he announced that. And in fact, I asked an appointment with him to thank him, but this was again arranged through a webinar that I thanked him for his immediate announcement. And you know, we got the protocol and the other notification, GO is ready for that. And every day, Dr. Muruganathan knows our DPH and DMS talking to IMA, and they realize the importance of the private sector, because the private sector is very, very important in handling this COVID infections. Of course, we have so many issues to deal with that, because the hospitals are the more or less a small or epicenters where the disease can spread. That is very, very important. That's why Dr. Suman has given very elaborately how to go about all these things. And now we know that during this period, 80% of the hospitals are, the beds are vacant, and we have our own financial problems also. And we need to sort it out. IMA is working on that and to how to deal all these things. And immediately after this webinar, by about 7:30, we have another webinar particularly on this issue of handling the financial problems. And also, the issue is not going to settle down in the near future. Then we have to live along with this, and we have to handle and make ourselves very, very protective in the environment, and which every one of you know that. And you know, we have to suspect every other patient as a COVID positive patient and act accordingly. And in fact, we are going to get the stranded, the Indians who have been in abroad, not able to come down to our homeland, they are going to come in now, and that is another big challenge for us. And also the problems of the repeated disinfection and the PPEs, which is going to be there for a long time, and everything involves the cost. The additional cost is going to be there for us, and how we are going to manage all these things. And also another important thing, you cannot thoroughly every day disinfectant every point we touch. It is humanly not possible. As far as possible, we can do it. But on the other hand, we have to slowly getting into the herd immunity, which is another big challenge. The vaccine is not in the near future. There is no set treatment for the COVID infections. And by God's grace, every one of you will agree, the disease pattern in India is something different from the abroad. Fortunately, the death rate is not that bad when compared to the Western countries, most developed countries. But the infection rate is seems to be quite high. But as predicted, as Dr. Suman said, some of the papers, they predicted will be very high, 5.35 lakhs would be in mid-May. It is not so. And we are somehow, it is blessed, but we cannot keep quiet and take it for granted. And we have to gear up and work. And also, there is a big issue of the small and medium hospitals, and they are, most of them are closed down, and one by one they are opening it now. We ourselves asked our senior citizens not to go to the OPD, those who are more than 65 with the comorbid conditions, not to open up the clinic for another 2 or 3 months. If at all, they can work with our junior colleagues. And the another problem, this morning one of the journalists, he was asking, doctor, is there the death rate, overall death rate, has it come down in our country? And because the lockdown, there is no accidents and the stress-free life, automatically the death rate has come down. And you know, another issue of working with the small and medium hospitals, getting the paramedical personnels to come in, because every parent of the paramedicals, they are worried. They don't want their girl or boy to go and work in the hospitals, the fear of getting the infection back. And in some of the villages, I know they never allow the paramedical persons to go into their village and prevent them going to the hospital. Another big problem we have. And also the problems, if you are not going to see the patient again, medical legal issues are coming. And these things are we have to address. And then another issue of telemedicine, Dr. Suman was telling, when pediatrician was about to be charged, which we have prevented through our fellow association, the pediatric association. We are very much allowed to collect the fee for the telemedicine, but other issues of recording it and everything should be there. So many issues which is coming every day and night, and IMA is very much working very, very hardly to address all these things, because every doctor is asking some question or other. And I'm very, very sorry to say this, we are posting so much of protocols and informations, and people are not reading them or updating them, but repeatedly they are asking questions, what you have done. And for that, their own purpose, we have uploaded everything in our website, and this is available for all our doctor colleagues. And we are here to help our own fellow private doctors, and whatever the crisis and problem comes up. And with this few remarks, I think I have taken enough time, and what IMA has done, and we yet to do so many things. With the help of the seniors like Dr. Muruganathan, we'll be able to do more and more on this aspect. Thank you so much for your patient listening and giving me an opportunity to be with you this evening. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Raja, for that wonderful description. All of us agree, IMA is the mother of all organizations. Whether it is APA or ASA or obstetrics or applicable, everything comes under IMA. IMA is the mother. And whatever IMA gives directions, all of us are bound to follow. And your rapport with the government officials and the ministry is very good. I kindly maintain and go ahead. Now, another point, you know, which I want to tell every one of you, when somebody comes as a patient, if they don't have a mask, don't allow them to go to the doctor. You give them a mask. Suppose you have an extra mask, or you buy a mask and keep it and give the mask to the patient. Without the mask, the patient should not go to the doctor. And then the nurse also should be trained how to wear a mask for the patient. You know, you must teach them. Many times when the patient have the mask, they touch over the face and they touch the nose. So tell them how to wear a mask and what precautions they must do. And IMA has come out with a beautiful formula how a sanitizer can be made by yourself. You don't need to buy outside. You can make your own sanitizer. That is also available in the IMA. Every day, new news are coming. Today I saw the peritoneal fluid also, the virus is there. And then the testicular swelling is one of the signs of COVID. So sometimes, you know, even semen can, you know, send the virus. It may be sexually transmitted like Zika virus. So all those things are there. And the history taking, you must train the nurse what all the history you must take. Like, you know, whether they come from containment area, red zone area, whether the patients, the attendants have problems, whether they have any breathing difficulty. All those history you must take before you send the patient to the doctor's chamber. So these are all important things, but you must train the nurses and paramedical staff and receptionists. Now I'll go to Dr. Mridubhashini. Mridubhashini, are you there?
I'm here.
Yeah. So another biggest challenge is pregnancy. And government says you have to do RT-PCR for an expected cesarean 5 days earlier.
Yes.
For example, my wife had a cesarean yesterday. That patient's due date was 26th May, but she landed yesterday. Mm-hmm. There was no time for us to do RT-PCR. And we have to take the risk. Yes. And of course, we'll have to do all the other precautions. So, your wisdom on that. And especially when the pregnant lady comes, they always come with attender. So, we'll have to take the attender also. So, there are issues for obstetrician. Your views and words of wisdom from you.
Okay. I think there are a lot of implications. Yes, most of the societies, professional societies from all over the world are suggesting RT-PCR to be done prior to a procedure, cesarean or whichever procedure you're doing. And we all do it about a week ahead of time. But we all again know that a positive one is has got some significance, but if it's negative, it can turn out to be positive at any given time. So 1 week later, there's no guarantee that that patient is not going to have the virus. So we literally have to treat each one of them, whether they are positive or negative, as people who are potential carriers. So when you're doing a cesarean section or a procedure on them, we have to have the complete protective equipment and deal with the entire situation, you know, which protects the anesthetist as well as the surgeon in a way that that they may be contaminated kind of thing. The problem comes in when it comes in at 33, 34 weeks with a ruptured membrane and a temperature. It could very well be a chorio or chorioamnionitis or some other reason for a temperature, but we still have to get worried. And wherever there is a clinical factor which is like that somewhere in between, we have to treat them as potentially infected, separate them. So we have to have an alternative labor room, alternative cesarean theater, where we are not doing the regular cesareans and regular deliveries, and we have to treat them as potentially infected with all the precautions that we possibly can. That's the only way we can do it. So routine screening, even though we are doing it, it's not an infallible thing. You know, there are things that can be missed even if you do that. So you have to potentially take the approach that any one of them can be can contain the virus at any given period in time. Antenatal care also has become very difficult because we can't see them as often that we usually do. The frequency that we usually do is suggested to be less now. So we make the antenatal care and antenatal visits minimal. We make the ultrasound examinations also as minimal as possible. So through the antenatal care, we do carry out a lot of the teleconsultations and in between the actual person to person. And Suman did an extraordinarily good job. And I think pretty well we do about the same things for an OP and how to run the OP. I must say that our doctors initially wanted a PPE to be used in the OP also. We didn't want to say no, we did provide them. But however, most of them cannot work with a PPE in the OP for all day. It's just not possible. You can't keep wearing it for several hours and it becomes meaningless also when you see multiple patients with the same PPE. So we're not doing it. We're doing it exactly the way you're doing it now with all the other protective gear and not the whole body cover kind of thing. Again, a lot of other unusual situations come for us also. Early in the pregnancy, if somebody conceives and they're not planning, they get worried about the fact whether this virus can have an effect on the baby, whether they need to be terminated or they can carry on with the pregnancy. It has not been shown, this virus so far has not been shown to have any effect on the growing fetus inside. And unlike Zika and a few other viruses, this has not been associated with abnormalities. So universally, it's the final thing that termination of pregnancies need not be carried out just because somebody conceives at this given period in time. And otherwise, the prenatal care goes as usual. We also do not do any infertility treatment at this point in time. And infertility, even though women's health care, all of it is there, it's only for pregnancy care that we are doing. Infertility care is minimal and gynecological care also is minimal.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Mridbhashini. We will come to you. We'll have a few questions after the other panelists finish their talk. I'll ask you. Matthew Philip, are you there?
Yeah, I'm there.
Okay. Matthew, I think I will ask you a few questions instead of, you know, I have got about 7 questions for you. So maybe I'll ask questions, each question you answer, that way it'll be good.
Yeah, it's okay.
In these COVID times, it is prudent to do an elective endoscopy procedure or should we continue to practice only emergency therapeutic endoscopy? What is your view?
Sir, it depends upon where you work and what is the load of cases for COVID. But if you think that there is evidence of community spread, and I think, you know, in that cases or when the COVID cases or the COVID fear is till it is over, I think it's prudent to do only emergency cases. And you know that our society has made a joint advisory, and it is, in fact, many advisories have been made by different societies. And they made it that, no, in this time, it's better to select and do emergency cases. See, what are those emergency cases? They are actually upper GI bleed. They cannot wait. Or significant lower GI bleed. or a patient with cholangitis, or a patient with a foreign body. So all these patients actually need to be done immediately, whether they are COVID positive or COVID negative, it doesn't matter. And but what we have to do is that we have no facility for doing an RT-PCR or any other rapid test. So all these patients has to be considered as positive, and then you have to take precautions for that. But there is another group. It's actually an urgent group or a semi-emergency or semi-urgent one. They are actually those patients with a malignancy. They have got a esophageal obstruction and you need to put a stent. Or another patient with a malignant biliary obstruction, you need to put a stent. Or a patient with a colonic obstruction, which where you do an endoscopic stenting. And or a patient has got a malignancy, you need to do a staging procedure for that. We cannot wait for long. But in those cases, we have to also accommodate these patients now. But all these elective procedures, for example, screening colonoscopies and all for endoscopy for dyspepsia, etc., all these patients need not be done now. But once the workload or once the COVID load comes down or the fear is gone, then you have to take up these cases, but very gradually. But now, whatever being done, if the patient's condition deteriorates, or if you think that the patient is unlikely to, is not able to wait for long, in those patients, individual, you have to take an individual decision on these elective cases.
Okay, Matthew. Yeah. What is the recommended dress code or attire for endoscopists or technicians? And then is it full PPE, surgical gown, N95? And do you do in the negative pressure room or normal room?
So it again depends upon actually how you triage your patients. And as you know that when we have actually changed a lot in accepting our patients for endoscopy, you have told about the social distancing, as well as for, even this is true for patient coming to the endoscopy suite. Actually, we screen them. There is the pre-screening room itself. The sister used to take their temperature, which was never used to take in our department earlier. And also we take a history, whether there's a history of fever, travel to a place, red spot or a cluster area, or they have got any respiratory symptoms, etc., and all this, any close contact with the patients, and or any health worker working in their home or a health worker itself. These are all actually risk factors. Then we classify them as high risk, intermediate, and low risk, or at least high risk and low risk. And then you divide your patients for PPE. But I tell you, when we are worried that there is a community spread, then every patient is okay. We are not doing any screening test. Then in that case, we should actually use PPE for all patients. Then PPE means that there are different components. So what is my PPE? Just by wearing a mask is also a PPE. But in our unit, what we practice is that everybody is given N95 mask in the endoscopy healthcare worker. Every patient has to wear a mask. That is the surgical mask or a simple mask when they are waiting in the endoscopy waiting area. And when these patients are done, we reduce the staff inside the endoscopy room. Only one doctor and maximum two assistants. Assistant means nursing assistants and one endoscopy technician. So minimum numbers of people in there. And then we give them N95 mask, a face shield, hair net, and then we use a gown and a shoe cover. This is standard for all of us. And our face shield is reusable. It can be washed and reusable. But N95 mask, we actually use, sometimes we use external use, or sometimes we reuse also. So likewise that Suman has told, we actually use only once. I mean, one day we use it and then we keep it aside. And we take another. Everybody is given 4 N95 masks. So we reuse that in that way. But after a week or after multiple use, we throw it away. If it is obviously contaminated, we have to throw it away. And if there is actually, you have done a very prolonged procedure with a GI bleed, our patient has got aerosol procedure or a longer aerosol producing procedure for a longer period, you have to discard it. Or if you know that this patient is COVID positive, then you should not reuse it. Actually, that after that procedure, you remove it. So if you ask me, for a very low risk case, if it is proven that is negative by testing, in that case, you can use a conventional mask. You use a conventional, every patient in our unit, even otherwise, you use a gown and we use a shoe cover. And the question is only adding the face shield and N95 mask. So in routinely here we use N95 mask for all major procedures like ERCP or prolonged procedure, we use the full PPE. The only thing is that we have reduced the number of people inside the endoscopy room.
Do you use negative pressure room or ordinary room?
Sir, negative pressure rooms, actually, if you have got a positive patients of COVID-19, you should do a negative pressure room. And most of the centers in the world, not only in India, negative pressure rooms are not very common in the endoscopy suite. But there are, when you need to do, you can actually adopt measures to make it negative pressure by using exhaust fan or switching off the AC and all those things. Otherwise, it is not very common to use in this way.
Coming to a lot of reusable accessories used, you do use one time or reuse, and what are the reusable accessories in endoscopy?
Sir, I tell you that as far as possible, we should use single-use endoscopy accessories. You know, for example, biopsy forceps. Whatever you do for cleaning, it will not become clean. And biopsy forceps is quite cheap now, and we throw it away. But when it comes to a costly equipment, then you have to use the standard precautions for cleaning it. And in that case, most of the time, the count can become negative. But what we practice is that those equipments which we need to reuse, those are not reused for another 1 or 2 days. So we actually rotate that so that they are well sterilized. And it's actually for those simple things we never used to reuse. For example, mouth guard is thrown away, biopsy force is thrown away, and many of the cannulas which we use are thrown away like that.
Okay. Now, in India, because you are all very busy person, there may be 10 cases or 5 cases waiting. And how do you sterilize between the patients? You take a 5 minutes break and then do Cydax solution or what?
Sir, see, actually what we do is better to do for everyone also. The patient is wheeled in a trolley, and the same trolley goes out. And the same set of doctors, the same set of nurses and technicians, they follow the patient. And the cleaning of the room is standard for everything. And I don't think that we should really clean everything or fumigate after each procedure. What you have to do is, you know, all the critical areas, surfaces where the patient is likely to touch or you are likely to touch, and as Suman told, bring in very minimal things. And actually, I don't have the slides to show. Our endoscopy suit, the rooms are made empty. Most of the unnecessary accessories or furniture are taken out. So we have only one computer and no person for typing. The person sits in a remote area. So the minimal things are there. So what we use for cleaning, after every procedure, we actually clean the surface on the floor with the sodium hypochlorite, and on the surface table, all the critical areas like doorknobs or the rails of the trolley, etc., we clean it with alcohol or hypochlorite.
And what is the disinfection practice for endoscopy suits? UV light, fumigation with, or 70% alcohol or sodium hypochlorite?
Sir, standard is, sodium hypochlorite for the surfaces, for the floors, etc. And for fumigation, I think, fumigation is done only at the end of the day. We don't do, unless we have done a COVID positive patient, then we don't use that room that day. We actually fumigate and only use for the next day. And as I told you, cleaning solutions, there are different types of solutions. So it depends upon the local availability and the practice of the infection control team or the hospital that they decide about that. But all are equally good.
Okay. No, normally you do endoscopy under sedation. But in this particular time, because of the aerosol dissipation, you would like to do under sedation or even without sedation?
Sir, it's actually the choice of the patient. And we have adopted certain techniques by which actually the aerosol can be reduced. And Mohan must be knowing about that. Actually, we have adopted a mask with the mouthpiece, mouth guard, so that the patient actually we can pass the endoscope through that. And we give them an option. But generally, we are a little lenient towards sedation for endoscopy now when compared to the past, because we are afraid of aerosol generating procedure.
Okay, now I'll go to Dr. C.N. Raja. Raja, are you there? Raja?
Unmute. I'm there.
Raja, as a ENT physician, ENT surgeon, you do a lot of bronchoscopy, bronchoalveolar lavage and all that. So what are the protection equipment you advise for ENT people, even for daily examination?
Well, of course, nowadays we do only emergency cases, and there are no elective cases as of now. We are not doing at all. As already mentioned, I happen to do a couple of foreign bodies in the throat as an emergency. In that case, every one of us, we use the N95 mask and the face shield. And the anesthetist and myself, we were completely using the total PPEs. And you know, in the general anesthesia, the patient face was completely covered with a plastic sheet which is transparent, and the anesthetist was giving the anesthesia without directly exposing to the upper airway tract. So in this way he has given, and I used the total PPE along with the N95 mask and the face shield to do the endoscopy to remove the foreign bodies. But in the OPD, I use a separate dress and the N95 mask and the gloves which is there, and which I change every now and then. And of course, after every patient, I use the sanitizer or the soap and water solution to wash my gloved hand. And routine endoscopic procedure like nasal endoscopy and laryngoscopy, we are not doing now. Unless it is a CA patient, in that we take all the precautions which I mentioned earlier, the N95 and the face shield.
Raja, to avoid, daily when you give an OP, people will come with sore throat and tonsillar abscess and all that. Will you examine them or ask them to take a picture and come back? Because some of the ENT surgeons says we ask the patient to take a picture and bring it. What is your
I think by looking at the picture, okay, you can treat in case of telemedicine if the patient is there. And we have very clear-cut history. Before the patient comes into the OPD, we ask all the contact history and other things from where they are coming in, whether they are coming from the containment area or from either which place. All those things our sisters are taking under the... Before the patient comes in, I have the history in front of me. So if there is necessity, then I just ask them to open the mouth at a distance of 2 meters and see through the very good light. I don't put the tongue depressor because the gag will be there and they will try to cough it out, and which will affect the ENT surgeon who is sitting opposite to him. So avoid all these things. And examination of the ear, I don't use the otoscope. Instead, I use the microscope so that I can keep a certain distance, and the patient and the examining ear will be at a distance from me. So I don't use the otoscope, which with the otoscope, we have to go to very close to the patient and see the ear. So avoid that also. I'm doing such practice in my day-to-day clinic.
Okay. Thank you, Raja. I'll come back to you later. Dr. Mridubhashini?
Yes, I'm here.
Yeah. You get patients' antenatal checkup. Yes. What about your vaccine advice? You know, Tdap, influenza vaccine, etc. during this COVID times, do you advise them or how do they do that?
We do continue with the vaccination.
Okay, you send a message and ask them to come and take this?
Yes.
Okay. I have got other couple of questions from the audience.
Yeah.
Should we use the leg to open and close the doors? Suman, you can answer. Should we use the leg to open and close the door? Suman, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here, sir. Use the what? Leg, sir?
No, to use
to
the
open
leg,
the door.
Open and close
open
the door.
Open the door. Okay, fine, sir. The best way to open the door is from behind, like this, sir.
Okay.
The back of your body or your elbow to push and open. But it is not possible because most of our doors are one way. You're on the other side, we have to pull. That's why it is better to have a small sanitizer in your pocket. The minute you open, you just spray, you clean it and go. Because that will be the door handle will become a format transmitter.
Okay. Virendra Goyal from Rajasthan. What about digital record keeping?
Yeah. Digital record keeping. Yeah, yes. This system is available. I mean, even in any standard mobile phone, we have the recording is available. And okay. most of the telemedicine is done either from an iPad or from a mobile. And you can automatically record every conversation. And you can just put it in cloud. If you have a Google account, cloud, they give up to 1.5 GB space is free. And if you want a commercial space, it's just few hundred rupees. So it's not difficult to maintain a record keeping.
Yes. And Dr. TTS from Tirupur, what is the concentration of commercially available Lysol in any shop used for floor cleaning?
The commercial available right now is 80% benzalkonium chloride. That is the one. And I showed the proportion also. 1 cupful for 4 liters of water. That is the suggested proportion of mixing and diluting.
Is it mandatory for healthcare providers to undergo RT-PCR to treat cases?
I don't think it's neither commercial or practical, sir. It's pretty difficult.
Okay. Should we always use sanitizer after the hand wash?
There is no doubt about it. Even way back, Lister said hand wash is the best disinfectant. John Lister, the pioneer of antiseptic surgery, he said. Even today, hand wash for 20 seconds with soap solution is equal to or better than sanitizer solution. But for practical purposes, if you know our hands is not dirty, we can use sanitizer immediately and wipe it because we have immediate action.
We have got more questions, but I think the time is up. Now I will ask each panelist to give the drive home message. Let us start with Dr. C.N. Raja. You are Raja. One message.
One message I like to say, we have to accept the corona and live with corona and handle it corona with all the precautions to safeguard ourselves and our patients and our society for at least another 6 months to 1 year. This we have to learn and put it into practice. That is the bottom line.
Okay, very good. Mrithubhashini, madam.
I think we are all starting to accept that it's not a short-term thing. It's a long-term event. But for us in this field, the question then becomes what to do with our fertility patients, what to do with our gynecological patients, what to do with our oncology patients. I think they need to be looked at on a priority basis. And whichever way we can choose them, we can prioritize them and look after them in the safest possible way.
Dr. Matthew Phillip.
Yes, sir. I think, you know, this COVID, which has started in some part of the world and has become present all over the world, that has taught us that we need to be prepared for such things in the future as well. And many new normal has been introduced now. See, we are going to change a lot in many aspects. It has reminded us how well we are actually taking our own precautions to our safety measures in not only in examining patients, but also in doing procedures and how we are careful. And I think, you know, this is a very important era to learn about how we can protect ourselves and we can actually protect our patients getting infected. So I think this is a very important area to look at.
There are a couple of questions which I will answer and then I will wind up. One question was, should we do RT-PCR for all elective surgeries? It is always better to do RT-PCR if the patient can afford, because now the tests are available all over. So it is good for our doctors. So otherwise, in the containment area, patients, definitely you must do RT-PCR. Inform them 5 days earlier, do the test, get the report, and then do the elective surgery. That is for Palaniswamy, who in Tirupur, who has asked the question. And Sangram Bidar has said, whatever Suman has shown, it is good, but for a OP, for a regular OP, is it good? Suman, with your comments and your message.
Yeah, sure, sir. Like I said at the beginning of my presentation, from a single OPD suite to a multi-specialty hospital, this will hold. I even showed examples of 2 OPD suites, how they should be there, how they should keep the door open, how the screen can be there. That screen which we put up for one bed, it costs only 150 rupees. It's very cheap. It's available in any hardware store. And all you need is a tiller to stitch it to your height. So I think it's very much viable. It's not a problem at all.
Okay. I think I thank all the panelists for an excellent, messages.
Murugan, sir, Dr. BGM has joined us around half an hour back. He just wants to add a word.
I see. Okay.
Yeah,
Dr. VG Mohan Prasad, I will give you 2 minutes. Your comments and your words of wisdom. Mohan?
I'll take only 1 minute, sir. Like somebody was asking about what do you do when you touch doors? See, this is what I do. I'm carrying a sanitizer with me. So I just can spray like this and I can wipe myself. So I'm carrying it in my pocket all through ever since Corona was announced. So these are the personal precautions one has to take. As most of the panelists told us, and we have to think every patient is corona positive. before we handle them, because it's going to stay with us at least until December. And many people have said, including Dr. Shiv Sareen from ILBS, who has said that it's going to pick up in June, so even more. So I think we are in for trouble. So all of us should treat every patient as a corona positive patient. We should give enough social distancing when they come to our hospitals. I'm sure we should be able to fight it out, sir.
Bhavan, Mohan Prasad, it's a great commitment from you. I never expected you to come here because of your your family. You lost an important soul. But in spite of that, you have come. I really appreciate it, your great commitment. Thanks, Mohan.
Well, I came here just to thank all our great panelists and yourself, sir, the moderator, Dr. Muruganathan, Dr. C.N. Raja, our IMA president, Dr. Matthew Phillip, our Endoscopy Society national president, and Mridubhashini Madam, one of the top-notch obstetricians and the most seasoned obstetrician and gynecologist of Coimbatore. And I wanted to thank Dr. Suman for a wonderful presentation, and Dr. Muruganathan, as usual, beautiful moderation as he continues with all our ECP meetings.
I think I'll get a moderator PhD before the COVID times, I think, because I'm doing 20th webinar as a moderator. So, ladies and gentlemen, my brothers, it was a wonderful webinar. And as I said, the recording will be available. We'll put it on our website and you can also take it. And Dr. C.N. Raja is going to do another webinar in 7:45 with IMA Dr. Ravi Kumar. You are most welcome to join. And my concluding remarks is, as everybody says, corona will be there for another 6 months at least. We must learn to live with this, and then we must continue our good habits, whatever we learn. Like, you know, like the old grandee said, wash before you, hand washing before coming to the house, and then cough etiquette, then cleaning the surface, physical distancing, all that you must continue. All our, whatever good habits you learn, please continue to do that. And I thank Tablets for sponsoring this program. And I thank all the panelists for this. And I thank all the participants also for active participation. If you have any more questions, anything, you can directly call one of us or send a mail. And Raja has got already said, the IMA website also, we have the precautions for prevention and the protection. So be safe, stay safe, and protect yourself before you protect others. Thank you very much. Good night.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you all. Thank you. Thank you.